Welcome. I'm Dr. Jeff Borenstein.
Everyone is touched by psychiatric conditions, either themselves or a loved one. Do not suffer in silence. With help, there is hope. Today I speak with legendary musician and co-founder of the Beach Boys, Brian Wilson.
Good to be here.
Speak about the biographical movie Love and Mercy, about his experiences living with mental illness and his road to recovery.
Well, the first time I saw it, it scared me to death because, of course, the guy that played Dr. Landy, Paul Giamatti, very factual and very accurate and very much close to, even his voice sounded like Dr. Landy's voice. And it kind of scared me a little bit.
That's today on Healthy Minds. Healthy Minds is brought to you in part by the American Psychiatric Association Foundation, the Graham Beck Foundation, the New York State Psychiatric Association, and the New York State Office of Mental Health. Welcome to Healthy Minds. I'm Dr. Jeff Borenstein. Today I speak with legendary musician and co-founder of the Beach Boys, Brian Wilson. We speak about the biographical movie Love and Mercy, about his experiences living with mental illness and his road to recovery.
Ladies and gentlemen, the Beach Boys.
Greatest album ever made. Got all kinds of new ideas, new sounds, new instruments.
I may not always love you.
You can't just do whatever you want, Brian.
I got different stuff inside me. I gotta get it out.
You should know Brian is a very sick man.
Daddy, if you should ever leave me, well, life will still go on, believe me.
Sing what's in your soul.
You're nothing to me. So what good would living do me?
You need to find a way to get back to yourself.
Today I speak with Brian Wilson, Bill Poland, Dr. Barbara Van Dalen, and Paul Dano. They have joined the campaign to change direction.
These two gentlemen play Brian. Bill directed, Claire is a producer, Oren wrote it. An amazing collection of talent before you. Thank you all for coming tonight.
Dr. Barbara Van Dalen, the founder and president of Give an Hour, which organized the campaign.
We'd like to introduce Brian Wilson, Al Jardine, and the band.
The Campaign to Change Direction is a national initiative to change the culture in America about mental health, mental illness, and wellness by educating Americans to learn the five signs of emotional suffering so you can recognize them in yourself or a loved one who may be in emotional pain. The five signs are personality change. You may notice sudden or gradual changes in the way the person typically behaves. Agitation. The person seems uncharacteristically angry, anxious, agitated, or moody. Withdrawal. The person withdraws or isolates him or herself from other people. Poor self-care. The person stops taking care of themselves and may engage in risky behavior. And hopelessness. The person seems overwhelmed with hopelessness and overwhelmed with their circumstances. If you recognize that someone in your life is suffering, what do? You connect, you reach out, you inspire hope, and you offer help. Now my conversation with Brian, Bill, Barbara, and Paul. Thank you all for joining me. And I want to start off by, Barbara, how did you bring these gentlemen into the Change Direction campaign?
Well, thank you, Jeff. It's great to be with you again to talk about this really important topic. And you know, as you know, the campaign is all about changing the culture in America around mental health and mental well-being. And several months ago, I got an email from a dear friend who said, you must see this movie, Love and Mercy. And I said, why? And this person said to me, this film is all about changing the culture. It's all about spreading the message of Brian's life and what he went through and the importance of talking about these issues. So I went and saw it, and I reached out to a friend of mine who connected to a friend of his, and the next thing you know, I met and talked with Bill and Brian's wife, Melinda. Then I met Paul, and now we're doing amazing things using the film as a catalyst.
The film really is a springboard to help educate people, besides being just a wonderful story that really shows your life and in a very open way that I think is engaging to people. I want to start and ask, Bill, you're very passionate about this particular project, and it went on for a period of time because you wanted to get it exactly right. Mm-hmm. Tell us a little bit about the project.
Well, you know, when I first came to the project, I was mostly drawn by, you know, Brian Wilson and the music and the Beach Boys and all that thing. But and as I got to know the story a little better, certainly Brian's struggles and got to know him and Melinda better, it just, you know, that part of it took over. And as you go to make a movie, it is kind of an unfolding a lot of times of complexity and depth. And certainly to get to know and get to explore that part of it became more important, honestly, than just kind of celebrating the music.
Yeah. It's more than a celebration of music. It really is a celebration of health, of regaining health. And I want to ask, Brian, for you to maintain your health, what are the types of things that you do?
Well, every day I walk for a half hour, take walks for a half hour at a park, and I do a little sit-ups and little small exercises and stuff like that, yeah.
And I know that you also have medication.
Right, I take 3 times a day medication, yeah.
And the support of your family.
Right.
Probably, in many ways, the most important thing.
Right.
I'm gonna turn around to you, Paul, and ask you, what was it like to play the young Brian Wilson?
It was a lot of things. It was really scary and really exciting. It was an honor. I think, like Bill, my first entrance into it was through the music and through the aspects of sort of creative joy, you know, being in the studio, the feeling of making music, and then, you know, the scary part was dipping into the onset of mental illness on behalf of the character. And I think what's really interesting about it is, you know, your character feels like a real person to you, and it's really hard to put them through that. Meaning, I wish I could have protected that person, because you realize how scary it is and how alone it sort of feels. You know, you would be afraid to tell somebody at first because you're feeling things that you think may not be normal. And you're fighting against it rather than just trying to play the symptoms, so to speak. You know, when you start feeling that way, I think most people don't want to. And so it was that feeling, you know, for the character wishing that, you know, you could do something for them to help them, is part of why I was very excited to hear from Barbara, because, you know, I felt like I had a firsthand experience of wishing I could have given some help and compassion to somebody struggling.
As the director, what was it like for you to get the actors to really bring that to play?
It's always a challenge, but in this case, we have a living person, a person who's there you can draw on. Not only that, but a whole history of recordings and film and photographs of Brian's entire life. So there's a lot to draw on, plus the man himself.
Plus Brian.
The most important thing. But honestly, you know, we portray the two parts of Brian's life, you know, in the 60s and in the 80s. And I think for Paul and John Cusack to prepare, it was a different process for both of them. I think it really depended on what they were drawn to, what they thought as the kind of natural way into the character. But it seemed to make sense as it all worked out that John ended up spending a lot of time with Brian to prepare for his character, whereas Paul, not as much at the beginning. I mean, he can speak to that, but it's just a different process of trying to wrestle with those two, in some ways different. They're the same person, but different eras in a person's life.
What was it like for you, Brian, to actually see the film?
Well, the first time I saw it, I was scared me to death, because of course the guy that played Dr. Landy, Paul Giamatti, very factual and very accurate and very much close to, even his voice sounded like Dr. Landy's voice. And it kind of scared me a little bit.
Right, that must have been frightening.
It was,
that must have been frightening. And to see them portraying how you went through this, what was that like for you?
Well, I was proud to see that how factual it was, you know, that they could deliver their lines, you know, in a way that I would have wanted them to.
I mean, I can jump in here because, I mean, Brian's very humble about these things. But it was amazing about approaching this film and allowing us to kind of step in and, you know, kind of work with him and kind of try to paint that portrait. I mean, you can never paint the ultimate or definitive portrait of anybody, but he was so giving. Both Melinda and Brian were so giving in allowing us to kind of deal with some pretty difficult parts of their lives. I mean, it would be easy or more natural for a person to say, sure, I'd love a movie made about myself, but you know, let's go in this direction,
right,
or let's go in that direction. And they weren't that way at all. They were so kind of open and genuine and sincere about wanting the film to be kind of honest and
authentic.
And, you know, yeah.
I mean, I think that was one of the things that was so powerful for me when I saw it. And I think I told Paul that, and I said that to Bill and to Brian and Melinda too. The film does such a beautiful job of being authentic. And at its core, it really is a love story. In sort of different aspects of different love stories, it's the young Brian's love of music. And it was just so apparent how powerful his love was for his craft and what he was doing. And then later, of course, Melinda's love for Brian and she wasn't willing to abandon him.
Not willing to give up, no matter what.
And she saw the signs. She saw what was happening, and she stepped in to help. And it was all done through the collective creative genius of the writer, the director, the actors, and Brian and Melinda that created this amazing story.
One of the key aspects of the movie is how, Paul, you were able to really help us get inside what it would have been like for Brian at that point in time. How did you do that, other than being a good actor?
No, it's a tough question to answer because, frankly, it's sort of one of the things that keeps me going with it, but one of the frustrating things is it's a very mysterious process. You know, I wish there was a formula. I wish there was more math to it, because then I would know every time I can do it. But frankly, you do feel like, well, how can I do this? You know, I think one thing that's interesting was it was equally important for me to put time into the joyful parts of Brian and his relationship to music as it was to his struggles. The music is what kept me afloat while doing it, because there were days that were challenging. You really, it's a seesaw. You know, when in a day you might do a scene where you're lit up hearing the song Be My Baby come from the stereo and being inspired by it, and then later that afternoon, you know, possibly doing a scene where you're really struggling. And you know, Brian's music is what really kind of kept me afloat during the times that were harder. And that reminds me of something I think I read that he said, or Brian said it to me, was that he wanted to make music that would make people smile and help them heal. And I think for somebody who was struggling to have such a generous spirit, you know, that was a really beautiful and inspiring thing.
I agree, and I think for countless millions of people, your music has brought joy. One of the things that you've spoken about in interviews is having to deal with hallucinations and be able to still function with them. And
well,
I'm curious,
I've
how do you do that?
For 45 years. So, you know, I've had a little practice in dealing with the voices in auditory hallucinations.
What do you do to deal with them? Because there are people watching right now that could benefit from your guidance on that.
I hope they can identify what I went through, and they can identify, and I can identify what they went through, you know.
And what do you do to sort of push the voices off to the side so you can concentrate on other things?
Sometimes I'll yell inside my head, you know, and, you know, I'll say, stop talking to me, like that kind of thing, you know.
Okay, and that helps you maintain control over focusing on what you want to focus on.
Right.
That's very good advice. That's helpful to people.
Okay.
So thank you. Barbara, as the person who is leading this campaign, and you have a lot of people working with you, what are you seeing?
Amazing things. I feel like we've stepped into a moment in time where our country is ready for this change. And I think Bill and I had a chance to work together a few weeks ago at a university, and we were there with young people. We showed the film, Elizabeth Banks was with us, and Oren Moverman, the writer. And it was clear that the students, they want to embrace this. They want to be open and be able to talk freely. They don't want to feel the guilt, the shame. They were really interested in finding out, okay, once we kind of get rid of the things that get in our way, once we're free to talk, what do we do? How do we help each other? You know, you asking Brian. I think we're at a point in time in our country where people just want to be who they are. And we all deal with mental health. It is part of all of us. Sometimes it's good, sometimes it's not. And I think we're seeing that with the campaign. We now have, you know, 180 plus partners joining. That must say something, that there's a desire to change the culture. And this film, I mean, it really was, I feel like the universe delivered the film to me that night and said, use this. And when I reached out, they all said, yes, we want to help.
I think one of the keys of the film and of Brian sharing your experiences and then the work that you all did to bring that to life is that there is stigma and prejudice against people who have depression, other psychiatric conditions. And being able to show that condition, show what it's like for the person, I think makes a big difference. I'm curious, as a producer and a director, where often Hollywood portrays these things in a negative way, what inspired you to do it in such a positive way, such an engaging way?
Probably Brian and Melinda. I think, you know, you're kind of taking away a lot from what, or drawing from them, you know, inspirationally. I mean, I guess the thing about these things is these are the kind of things that at least I and I think a lot of people would like to do in film and in other forms of art is to address some of these issues or have people, you know, whatever, have them be come away from it moved or changed in some way. On the other hand, if you try too hard, if it becomes too, you know, specific and kind of on the nose, people are turned off. So it's almost like you gotta back away a little bit from it and just kind of approach it in a very, I don't know, natural or kind of way. You gotta not ignore it, but you know what I mean? If you try too hard, it becomes preachy or whatever and people can't relate to it. If it's more like here, it's just, we're just telling the story of Brian Wilson and Melinda. And it, we're not like trying to specifically do something. We're just trying to have an honest portrayal. And then hopefully, I think it's coming out, you know, the message and the influence is coming out through that as opposed to us preaching about it.
Can I ask Bill a question?
Yes.
Are you surprised by the power of the film and how, you know, in terms of the campaign coming to you and all this interest, does it surprise you that the film actually is serving this kind of powerful role in the culture right now?
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, first, you know, as a director and maybe all of us experience this when you're making a movie, you're kind of the equivalent of sitting in a dark room, I mean, which I literally was doing editing the movie. You're sitting in a dark room for a long period of time, and you don't know what you've got because nobody's seen it. And so you're really paranoid that it, you know, it's going to be horrible or people aren't going to relate to it. But, you know, in the back of your mind, the good thing is you're hoping that maybe something like this would happen, that maybe somebody, you know, if it's just one person or a couple of people that understand that this is really about Brian Wilson, the human being, and the struggles that he's had versus this is about, you know, the Beach Boys and all the fun we've had or something like that. It's not really, you know, and so when people connect with that, and now for Barbara and her organization to come forward and connect with that and then bring it to a wider audience, that's pretty exciting.
Yeah, it's extraordinary. It really is. And I think one of the keys is bringing it to younger people. We know, as we saw with Brian sharing his life story, a lot of times these illnesses begin in youth. And I'm going to turn to the youngest person in the room with us right now. What's your take on the younger generation and how they look at mental illness as opposed to some of the older people?
Yeah, I think, I mean, I can really only speak for myself and like my friends and then, you know, maybe my parents or family or, you know, the people I know. I do think that my generation is more vocal and a bit more open than I think possibly, generations above on this particular subject matter. I think it's really important that we continue to make it, you know, an open thing to talk about. I still think that there's probably a good amount of shame or certain things that come along with feeling that way that make it hard to speak out about, or that make it hard to say to somebody else, are you feeling okay? So I think there's still, you know, probably quite a ways to go. You know, it doesn't feel quite like the way we address physical health yet, and I think maybe it could be more along those lines.
I think that's the goal, to get to that point.
Yeah, but I certainly think, you know, the people I know are getting closer to that, and I think, you know, it takes, sometimes does take somebody sharing their story. You know, that's one of the things about art. You can actually make somebody feel less alone in their own struggle by seeing it, you know, in somebody else. And Brian shared that with us, and we got to make the film, and we all get to share that. And then, you know, it takes somebody like Barbara, and you know, we get to share that with you. And you know, it's really brave for Brian to have done that, mm-hmm. and to share in this way. And hopefully that, you know, gives license to somebody else to do the same thing.
Yeah, I agree with you. And it really, Brian, is brave of you to do this. And I think is a model for other people to be able to do this. And your music has brought joy to so many people, but this is bringing health to so many people.
Right.
And I can't tell you how much I appreciate you doing that.
Thank you very much.
Good. I'm going to ask one more question.
Okay.
And it relates to, I saw that you spoke about what it was like to see the young you portrayed by Paul in the studio creating the music.
Well, I was very proud of myself and Paul too, you know, for doing such a good job portraying my producing records and talking with people. So I was very proud of Paul and proud of myself.
Good. Well, I want to say thank you so much, especially to you, but also to the team that brought the movie to life, to Barbara for helping to bring this message to the world, but especially to you, Brian, for sharing your story in such a moving way.
Thank you very
to
much.
To help people.
Okay.
Thank you. So many of us love the music of the Beach Boys. Brian Wilson has been able to bring joy to countless millions despite having a chronic and persistent mental illness. His life is an inspiration and demonstrates that with help, there truly is hope. Until next time, I'm Dr. Jeff Borenstein. Goodbye. Thank you. With help, there is hope. Healthy Minds is brought to you in part by the American Psychiatric Association Foundation, the Graham Beck Foundation, the New York State Psychiatric Association, and the New York State Office of Mental Health.
Let's do Love and Mercy.
Love.